introduce this primarily because I believe some people are not really into it. And let's face it, in teaching, sometimes we feel we're comfortable with the content, but we're not comfortable whether the students are really getting what we want to share, isn't it? So I think that is where we need to bridge a little bit of a gap. Okay? It's not that we are not capable of, but I think as part of the lifelong learning exercise, this is something that we need to venture into if it's going to be effective. Okay, so don't be scared if you don't have. Okay? No grades here will be given. Philip,
mm-hmm.
How many times have you encountered this thing?
Quite a few. Dr. Logan has been professing about this, five orientations of learning as well. All my lectures in the master's program are really emphasizing more of the social learning and constructivism. Quite a lot of times I feel like really encountered this. This is more of a refresher from this, but, and also from coming from a different perspective, such as yourself.
Have you engaged yourself in teaching?
I've talked on and off. I wouldn't say totally immersed in teaching, although I've already submitted my transfer request to join the School of Communication, so hopefully that will turn out.
Wow. This is an aspiring good lecturer. Okay, that's good. Okay. By the way, Philip is not from the academics. Philip is from the student development
group,
isn't it? Yeah. She's thinking of shifting gears later on. And join the messy group of teaching.
Teachers.
True. Okay, so yes, this is how many sessions would be? Second, third?
Third.
Oh, see, I remember the dates. So you are from what school?
SME.
Oh, architecture. Have you encountered this thing? The five orientations of learning? Not really. Don't be scared. We want to baseline, so don't worry. I just want to know how will I approach the explanation. Should I go into some more details, you know, in order for others to, you know, come up with a better appreciation. Okay. So we'll see. Don't be scared if you don't have any idea yet. This will be my objective, that after 3 hours this afternoon, we will truly say, now I know why. Now I know why learning is difficult. Because we've gone through it, isn't it? But I think the basic question is, how far did we reflect on our own experiences well? Because lifelong learning is not a theory. Lifelong learning is natural. You will find out later on. There's no stopping in learning. It's not a principle, it's not a theory that somebody is taught. Lifelong learning is true, and it's innate, you know? It is humanly innate, meaning it's natural for human being to learn, whether it is formal or informal, okay? Yes, ma'am?
Yes.
From what school?
Same.
Oh, okay. Have you encountered five orientation learning?
Not really in this orientation with that. I look at cognitive thinking, I look at this kind of thing, but I'm not sure about this kind of orientation, but I think it's more or less it's related.
Okay, so let's see. So shall we start? How many registered so far in online?
One fourth.
So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Still means 6.
Hello, my friend.
Hello.
Welcome.
No, you're not. I know you mentioned you're going to attend.
Yes.
Yeah. Now I'm scared. I think Catherine is also joining from communication.
Oh, homeschool.
They have an activity now. Anyway, we'll try to start with some of the conversation that I started earlier. So don't be scared if you don't have any ideas yet. Now, disclaimer, okay? I'm not going to sing, I'm not going to dance this afternoon to entertain you, okay? Because I saw the video of the, during the teacher's day, were you there? In the student presentation of the video appreciating teachers, you know, and the running theme that they identified is fun and funny. You know, they equate good teachers with fun and funny. I want to test that hypothesis. You know, whether the learning is taking place when there is fun. And the teacher is funny. For me, it's quite interesting to say funny. I think funny is okay. Okay? So, the idea of teacher is someone that will entertain them and that will hold their attention for quite some time. Okay? Their interest. So, I don't know if that is also your perception, but I think what is important here this afternoon is, yes, it is a theory discussion or theories. I will present theories that we will discuss. Okay, it will be heavily on discussion, but I think the benefit on your part is not from the things that I will totally say, but from your own perspective and your own reflection. Okay, how far and how much do you really understand and appreciate the concept? And what will be the implication of this to your work? Okay? Not necessarily here in Taylor's, but in your engagement with people. You can use this even with your kids, if you are having kids who are in school now. Okay? If they are telling you that and having difficulty understanding mathematics or geometry or science, you know? Don't just say, hey, just sit down there and read a book, okay? Because there are other elements involved in it, and that we need to understand, okay? So let's start with some of these things. Okay, look at the synopsis. This is what I will cover for the entire 2 days initially. But because there were requests to come up with only one schedule in order not to cut the momentum, okay? So is it June 1, Ange? The supposedly second session. So instead of having a second session, I will finish it until 5. So we extended at least 1 hour. Okay? How many are taking this for NAC accreditation or okay? Only 1, 2, 3, 4 for NAC. So there are 2 equivalent modules for taking this. Okay? So that means I think we communicated that if you need this for NAC, make sure you put there this training, and I will sign 2 modules equivalent for you, okay? Now, another one is look at the coverage. Behaviorism, humanism, cognitivism, social learning, and constructivism. How are we going to journey with this development? That's one I will try my best, okay? We will look at this from the perspective of the theory, and at the same time, in the social context of the time. So there is a timeline that we will see in the 19th century timeline. Okay? How this orientation came about, and why is it our educational system is designed this way? Okay? Because sometimes we just immerse into it, the system is there, but actually we did not understand how it operates. Okay? Sometimes how we experience teaching is how we are now teaching. You know? How we see the characteristics of the good teachers that we know, we bring into the classroom, isn't it? But we don't have the real orientation on how to understand learning from that perspective. Okay? So we will journey in these five orientations, and that is the equivalency for two NACI modules. Any combination of module 1, 4, and 5, or any module that you think you might not be able to get anymore, I'll try to consider. Okay? So there are two major topics that we will discuss: the nature of learning and the five orientations, how learning is taking place. Okay? So the idea here is to understand what is learning, what is my basic understanding of learning. That's why I started with this. What is learning? What do you think is learning? How far do you think you can define learning, or how far you can explain learning? Anybody? Don't be scared. This is a learning experience for us, you know, this afternoon. I might discover something that is not with me now, you know, and it's already with you. I would rather be enriched. Yes?
It can take place, it's acquiring of knowledge, but it can take place voluntarily, or sometimes it can take place ad hoc, on the spot. You learn something, it doesn't have to be academic. It's acquiring of knowledge and application of knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Now, the key word that she used is acquire. Do you think knowledge is acquired?
Constructing meaning to what is being learned.
Process.
Constructing meaning.
Process.
Undergoing a certain process. What else? What do you think is learning?
Process of absorbing information and be able to understand it.
Hold on to the verb you're using, okay? Absorbing, acquiring, constructing. What else? Hold on to it, because we will try to see whether you will still have the same verb when we end up this thing later on. Okay?
Knowing something.
Knowing something. But that is learning.
Knowing something new.
So what is learning? Knowing something new. So if you know only old things, that's not learning. I'm just challenging your perspective. Don't worry, don't be scared. What else? Knowing. Okay, we have acquiring, we have absorbing, we have constructing meaning, and we have process, we have knowing. What else?
Come on. Changing mindset.
Change. What else?
Explore.
Okay. Now,
adopting.
Okay. Now, given that initial surface, okay, idea of learning, where do you think you are coming from when you say those verbs? What made you decide to choose that definition, that explanation? Let's see where you are coming from. Why constructing meaning?
But some of them may just listening to you and not be bothered. I don't know.
position here is from the perspective of formal learning. Okay? It's a student and teacher type of learning. Okay? Now, what else? Acquiring.
Think from perspective of a person.
Why do you think you say it's acquiring? I'd just like to find out where you're coming from.
From what I do, and as a person, this might sound a little bit as a person who keeps learning, so it could be a very general way of seeing everything. It could be anything. So
it can be, like you said, learning can come in various forms, whether informal or formal, that's the way it is. It's an acquiring thing, it's a process of getting new ideas.
Okay.
What else? Anybody else? Absorbing.
Yes.
I hope I can still remember the verb until the end.
The reason why I say absorbing is because learning relates to the uses of mind, how your mind interprets knowledge, and how your mind is able to like connect it to past experience in order to understand. It's more on how your mind interprets.
Okay. There's another challenging idea that the lady is giving us on the table now. Mm-hmm. Apart from constructing and acquiring, the mind decided to enter into the picture. Okay? I don't know how far I can explain the mind. Okay? But we will see, okay? Because this orientation is the same orientation that is now present in most schools. You know? Each has its own concept of learning, and what we miss is to understand how students see learning. You know? You have your own perspective of learning as a teacher. But how is your student looking at learning? Did we ever explore? Okay? Now, top of that two concerns by looking at learning is other supporting efforts to explain learning, which is now very evident in the last 10 years, the neuroscience. The contribution of the neuroscience to explain the activity of the brain when it comes to learning. Okay? Before, we don't have the tools of the neuroscience. Okay? 1990 was declared the decade of the brain in the US. And that whole decade gave way to new findings. This is the only decade where huge amount of money was given to understand the brain. And one of the major implications they found out is that learning was defined differently in the realms of neuroscience. Okay? So we will see now this connection and find out if the five orientation will give us a glimpse to further construct our own meaning of what learning is all about. Can you react to this statement?
What do you think?
Do you share? Today the author is from Mark Smith. What's the implication of his statement? The lack of attention to the nature of learning inevitably leads to an impoverishment of education. So according to Mark Smith, we are now in a state of what? In a state of poverty. Education now is in a state of poverty. Of what? Of the understanding of learning. Everybody assume understand what learning is all about, isn't it? But education failed to give us a clear understanding how people learn and why people learn. Up to this point, I think the educational system did not and should not and failed in a sense, to give certain attempt, to really fully define what learning is all about. They thought changing physical structure or design like this one will elicit learning, isn't it? This is not a typical classroom setting now, isn't it? Your tables are different, you are seated differently. But why do you think classrooms are designed like that? It's like a lecture hall, initially, and now it's like this. Do you think by merely changing environment, you will create the condition for learning? Who said so? Isn't it? Some people now are embarking on other means like e-learning, online learning, isn't it? Because of the technology, isn't it? Some people still looking at other things like it should be a multi-mode learning because there is, according to one of the authors, I forgot the name, the author of the Multiple Intelligence, Howard Gardner, okay, thank you for that. Howard Gardner said multiple intelligences, meaning each of us might possess a combination of whatever intelligence, you know. Can be aesthetic, you know, you may be more into language, you are more into, you know, perceiving things, you are more into thinking abstractly, you know, all those things. You are more into locomotion or, shall we say, movement, okay? So all those things lead to that kind of poverty because some people believe, a lot of people in education cannot really define and cannot really explain what learning is all about, okay? I am not in a position to say I will make you richer after 3 hours, okay? But the poverty will always be there, okay? Or else I have no job. Okay, now I'm going to give you 3 major perspectives on learning, and you mentioned this a while ago. Learning is seen from the perspective of change. And it was started altogether. The learning is synonymous to change. And the initial people who tried to frame what learning is all about is to look at learning from the perspective of changing behavior. Okay? When our behavior changed, the theory said, you acquire new knowledge, that's why you are behaving differently. Okay, you will see that later on. Another one is, Philip mentioned, it is a process. You have to undergo, you know, certain steps or certain experiences for you to reach a certain level of knowledge. Then, this is what the educational system is looking at. Learning is product. Yeah. What's the implication, do you think, if it's a product? Then it can be rejected, isn't it? Yeah. What kind of education did you get? Is it a reject? Is it a substandard? Isn't it? So that is how we look at things. But it is, okay? Let's try to define it further. Look at this. As a product, they look at it as a change in behavior. They said, go to my school at the end when I give you the graduation certificate, definitely you will change. That's a promise. Okay? So the change in itself is a product. That is how school would like to look at it. If you don't know how to read and write, go to school and you will learn. Isn't it? That's the idea. What are the basic literacy? Reading, writing, arithmetic, isn't it? Still remember that? So people needs to read, needs to write, and needs to at least compute a little bit. Huh? At least you know what one plus one is 6 plus 2, but to some it's 3. No? Another one that it is a product is you need to demonstrate. Isn't it? Your knowledge. That's why I think in the profession of law, you need to demonstrate, you know, your ability to use the jurisprudence and the principles used, isn't it? To explain a case. And even in the field of arts and design, isn't it? It's the same thing. You need to demonstrate your knowledge by creating new things. You need to produce something. Okay? So they look at it from that perspective. Learning as an outcome, acquiring information or increasing knowledge. Okay? So I told you, get hold of that verb. Okay? We will fine-tune later on whether it is the limited or is it is limited or not. Okay? So going back, so look at the product. If learning is a product, this is your orientation. It should be acquired, okay? There must be change, and you need to demonstrate. Without this, your orientation of learning is not a product, okay? It might be another thing, might be a process. Learning is natural, even without a teacher, even without school, people will learn. Okay? Because before, there is no really educational institution in the society, isn't it? The way to learn is apprenticeship, isn't it? They work with their parents, they learn with their parents, you know? What they do, how they see things, you know? How they solve problems, isn't it? So it so happened that society became so organized and they found out education must be organized. So that people will know everything they need. Okay? So it comes in formal learning. So it's natural. Without any external intervention, what the biology said is that anybody will learn. They will naturally learn. You know? Even those people who are just waiting for the sunset to go down, their 8 hours in a day will produce certain form of learning. Okay? Next. Learning involves the whole person. What do you mean by that? You are learning not because only of the mind, but because your whole experience, your whole personality is involved. Okay? Your emotion, your motivation, your values, everything. You tend to learn having all this thing, all this function moving, you know, involved in the production of new knowledge. It's not only about the mind. That's why they said both physiological and psychological, something is happening. They proved that in neuroscience. They mapped the brain. They knew which part of the brain is really agitated and functioning and stimulated when you are angry, when you are hungry, when you are, you know, in doubt, when you are feeling down, you know, when you're happy. So they found out that learning is not just a product of mind process. It involves physiological changes. So the secretion of chemicals and the electrical energies that's going to your mind is not dichotomized with the brain, okay? And your mind is functioning chemically. That's what they're saying. So what they're saying as a process is that learning involves everything in you. Take note of that because we will pick up from there later on. This is one findings that the neuro research gave us. That no learning will take place without emotion. That's why the benefit of this new research in the brain gave rise to the interest again of the arts and the humanities. Those people who are more inclined into arts and into humanities, you are more likely to gain benefit. Why? Because they will find out later on that brain is highly activated with this kind of learning. Like music, paintings, you know? All these things. You see, paintings are not really talking like teachers, isn't it? But it evokes certain emotions and knowledge, you know? So here, what they are saying is that learning will not be triggered without emotion. Whether emotion belongs to your heart or to your, what do you call this? To your brain, okay? It doesn't matter. What is important is human nature, part of it is emotion, okay? Every time you will trigger emotion, learning will be somewhere along the way, okay? That's why if you're angry, something happens to you. I found out another book which discusses the naturalness of learning. They said every time that the survival instinct will be triggered, your ability to use the higher form of learning or mind processes will shut down. What are the survival instinct? Fight for flight, right? I think have you encountered that? The survival instinct? The fight or flight mode. It's either you fight or you run. You know? That's the basic survival instinct. And these are always being used up to now in our school. Don't study, you will fail. Take a lower grade, you don't have any future. Oh my God. If you cannot recite on my question, you have to stand up the whole period. See, once we trigger that, according to their research, the higher level of mind functioning shut down. So if you feel angry, you feel afraid, you feel discriminated, you feel low, the tendency, you won't be able to. Yeah, fear. So that is what they said. So here, emotion is playing now a very important role if you want to facilitate learning. That's why I like the arts, although the arts doesn't like me. I lost touch of art. My father is an artist, you know, a sculptor. So I grew up with him. I see the passion, and I'm questioning, why is it my dad can stay the whole day just working on, you know, an object like wood, you know? And at the end of the day, he's so happy that shape is taking place, you know? Then I found out, my God, my dad is so intelligent, you know? Why? Because he's self in what he is doing. It's not about knowledge. He did not even finish fine arts. You know? He only had 5 years of formal education. You know, our parents before are not really that educated in space, you know? But how come they can, you know, be passionate about what they're doing and still succeed, you know? That is why artists at this age, have you noticed that? So many singing contests, so many dancing contests, you know? The emergence of the art is coming to life. It's like a second Renaissance. It's in the period of Renaissance where people became intelligent, I tell you. So, learning is developmental, it is a process, and seen as an ongoing. That's why learning, as a lifelong learning concept, is natural, okay? Don't credit anybody because somebody wrote a paper and says there must be lifelong learning. It is natural. Anybody will learn at a given time. Now look at it as change. It is change because your tendency is to question the existing knowledge, the existing assumption. That's why that is where constructivist perspective is coming into the picture. You will change because you change your assumption. Like for example, if it is the first time you touch a fire and you got burned and you feel the pain, isn't it? What is the learning there? Huh? I'm not going to do it again. Isn't it? I'm not going to touch it again because it's hot. But is the learning in itself is just realizing it's hot? No. It involves an experience, isn't it? One, you have an assumption that it's not painful. That's why you decided to touch. But the moment you experience the heat, it sends signals to your brain that something is wrong, you know? The survival mode is coming in because there is pain, isn't it? And you don't want pain, that's natural. So tendency, you change your assumption now. Oh, fire is painful. I'm not going to touch it again. Okay? Just like kids, look at babies, do you think? By merely saying, hey, don't touch it, you'll get hurt. What do you think kids will do? They will touch it. They will touch it. Why? Because your knowledge, what you're saying, don't, is not registering because there is nothing in the mind. There is nothing in there about the fire, isn't it? The moment you experience it, that is the only time things will change. You see? Are we journeying? Are we still?
Yeah. Sometimes babies, what I did with my kids, I used to let them touch the hot things.
Mm-hmm.
It was very, very hot. So that they know this is hot.
Sometimes you have to let them explore, isn't it?
Yes, I will touch.
Yeah. But parents is always, don't. One thing they discovered again in neuroscience, the word don't is not captured by the brain. Okay? Take note of this. The not and the don't is not captured by the brain. So if you will see there, don't walk, the brain only see walk. That's what they found out. So if you're going to give instruction to kids, don't use the word not and don't. Tell them what it is, not the opposite. Okay? So if you will tell them, hey, it will hurt you, rather than don't touch it, there's a big difference. The brain is not responding if it is a negation, because a not is not present in the brain. So interesting, isn't it? That's why I need to read about the brain, you know? That is what you have, isn't it? Do you think you have it? It's the only part of your body that thinks for itself. Have you realized that? You cannot even teach your brain. The brain will function as itself, you know? That's why brain is selective. You cannot even dictate, hey, please memorize this definition word for word. I need this in the exam. You cannot do that to your brain, isn't it? The moment you go to the examination room and see that word to be defined, more likely you will forget. Because you're not in control. It is the only part of your body that has his own brain. Isn't it nice?
How we learn that?
Your brain is a memory bank.
Did you know that you are a slave of your brain? The brain only tells you what to learn and what to remember.
Isn't
that
me, myself?
Yeah?
The brain isn't me, myself.
That is a very philosophical question. Somebody said it already. Somebody already said that. Okay? Descartes already defined himself as the mind.
Okay.
You know the definition of philosophical context? He said, I think, therefore I am. Isn't it?
Yes.
But that is very philosophical. Learning involves a complex process within the individual. That's why it is changed, physiological and others. Okay? Next, learning changes the person inside out. It's true, isn't it? You cannot change outside and then inside. You have to change from within. You cannot just follow somebody. Just like if I will teach you how to dance, okay, you're looking at me, you're observing me, yes. But the change is not taking place outside. The change is taking place inside. Okay? That's why the change is happening from within, not from the outside. Okay? Not merely studying or looking at object means you will learn. Something has to change from within. Okay? Now let's journey. Let's journey with the time. The five orientation appeared in the last century. Look at it. Can you tell me what is happening at a certain point in time in history so that we can connect why people became oriented with something when it comes to learning? Why do you think the behaviorists appeared at this time? What is the mental model of it at that time? What's happening in our society at that time?
World War II. 1900s.
What is the most significant thing in human history in the 1900s?
The
industrialization.
Industrial age.
Yeah, industrial age. The start of the machines, isn't it? That is where the discovery of people are made to work. That is how they define humanity in the 1900s. If you don't have a job, you're not a human being. That's the concept. That's why you need to go to school, and the school there is apprenticeship. Isn't it? So you learn from the master, you know, during that time. That's why it's behaviorist, because people are designed to learn by merely changing what they are doing. You know? So if I will pair you to one master and you are the apprentice, the theory is that the apprentice will learn better by merely observing the master, okay, or the expert. That's how behaviorists became very influential at that time. That's why all schools are designed as a vocational school. It's a skill that you are trying to create or develop. And look at the influence. Until what time? Actually, spill over, you know, up to now. A lot of people are still behaviorists, isn't it?
Yes.
People think by merely looking at something, tendency others will learn, isn't it? That's the idea. And some universities now are somehow falling into the same trap in this period. They thought by just merely changing behavior, people are already learning. That's why here, copying is okay. Why? Because that's the idea. You copy what I do, and that is the right thing to do. Okay? Yeah. Isn't it? Then, during the 1960s up to 70s, what's happening? Why do you think humanness came about, especially in 1960s?
Hippie movement.
Huh?
Hippie movement.
The hippie movement in the West, isn't it? And what is that thing? What prompted the hip thing? Huh? It was the time when they gave women the right to vote. 50s. So that prompted a revisit by the humanist. No? Why? Because all those freedom loving and, you know, equality concept, you know, emerges in the West, influenced quite a lot, you know, the landscape, you know, of people, especially in the developing world. You know? Remember during that time, 1950s is the only time that women received their freedom to participate, isn't it? Prior to that, women are second-class citizens. You don't have the right. You know? It's a man's world. So the humanist comes in and says, wait a moment, something is wrong with the behaviors. You will see that later on. Now, why do you think cognitivists also entered in 1967? Somebody said, there is a mind, not only a brain. There is a part of us that thinks, you know? It's a good thing that they think about the brain, isn't it? They did not think about the knee thinking. Who says so that the brain is the seat of the mind? Nobody knows at that time, isn't it? No science that says it's something in your head that thinks, isn't it? Yeah. Look at the studies of the philosophers, you know, if you will look at the Western philosophies, you will find out they're not talking about the brain, at least not in the mid, you know, 1930s. You know, that the mind is there and the brain is the organ, you know. There is no such thing. So these people said there is an activity going on in the head. It's not only about copying behavior, it's not only about talking about humanity, there is also something going on with the brain, okay? Then later on, they found out that there is a better way. But it doesn't mean all these things are not running in our time. It's still present, I tell you. The social learning came about in 1977. What do you think is happening in 1970 to 1990?
Computer age.
The computer. Okay, so the technology, the technological advances, okay, during that time, prompted people to realize connectivity. It's not only now, you know, in the onset of this technology, they found out that now it's easy to communicate. Remember at that time, 1970 to 1990, the popularity of telephone, isn't it? And TV, you know? Became a medium to connect. These are media to connect the world, you know? I still remember when I was in my elementary years, for you to watch an international show like boxing, you know, the Ali show, you know, the Foreman, you know, all those things. I was so young then. And you know what? We really have to wait for its replay, not even the live telecast, you know? It's a replay, and it's a day-old story, and yet all the people, all my brothers and my father are watching it. Watch Miss Universe before, it's a delay. If you are in Asia, it's a delayed telecast, isn't it? But now, you're talking about streaming, live streaming. You don't even need television. All you need is your mobile device, and you can watch anything, isn't it? Now, look at the constructivists in 1990. What happened in the 1990s? After thinking about connections, came about constructivists. What did they realize at this point?
Information age. There's too much information.
We have the technology, then we have the information. Isn't it? This is where the time where information doubled more than what we can process. Unlike before, isn't it? Before, information is one at a time. If you want to study something, go to the library and borrow a book. And the librarian will say, you have a week to read the book. Isn't it? And you have to return it or else you will be penalized. That's how we work, isn't it? That's how important it is to have information, but on a very limited scale. But here in this period, oh my, anybody can learn. You know? That pushes the boundaries of learning and gaining information. Okay? Let's take it one at a time. Are we still here? Yes. Yeah? Any questions so far before I break it down? Now we will journey one orientation at a time, okay? And I will give you some highlights on why we think that way. So for the behaviorists, have you encountered this guy?
Yes.
Anybody who had a conversation with Ivan Pavlov? He survived until 1936 at least. But who is Ivan Pavlov? I will show you later on. Any idea? A Russian scientist who proved that
learning is conditioned.
Learning can be conditioned. I can make you follow rules. I can make you change your behavior. There is a way according to Pablo. B.F. Skinner. Yeah? Have you heard about him? He's not a skinny guy, actually. Somebody is named. Okay, you will see the contribution later. And J.D. Watson. Okay? These are the major, not only the three major, but there are several, people around the world who advocated for behaviors. But the most influential of all is Ivan Pavlov, because he sets the tone for classical conditioning. Okay? This is one way to look at it. This is the experiment. Okay? This is what happened. Just imagine, Pavlov believed that human being is like a dog. We have some drives and needs that will generate behavior. Okay? Look at the first picture here. Here, it is so natural for the dog to salivate, okay, when they see
food.
So Pavlov said, it is natural for dogs to do that. No stimulus can trigger salivation other than food. Okay? So, what Pavlov did is that, let's see another object using the bell. And Pavlov said, no salivation. Bell, food, food salivate, bell, no. Okay? He proved that he can change the dog's behavior by combining the two together at the same time. So, he introduced the bell, at the same time introduced the food. So several times, the dog was conditioned to see food, hear the bell, food, hear the bell, food, hear the bell, food, until such time, the dog now responds to the bell and salivate. So simple. Huh? But this scientific breakthrough gave the foundation to define learning as something conditional. Meaning, learning can be conditional. You can change behavior by looking at another object and use it together with the one that creates behavior. A good example of this in our time is the same thing. If you hear a bell, what do you remember, especially in school? Recess! Isn't it? The moment the kids will hear the bell, it's recess, you know? And that is one of the moments we are waiting for. When you grow up, the bell is still there, isn't it? It became an emergency thing for adults, isn't it? So what happened? This theory was picked up by people who are in the educational sector and said, oh, so if learning can be conditioned, people can be conditioned. Let's do it. You see? That's why most of us are product of classical conditioning. Did you know that? Now, at the time, no, I mean, here I still believe, because a former student of mine from UN, who is now teaching in a public school, discovered Roman is still there with the teachers. That is a form of conditioning, you know. The moment the kids will see see, rotan, it is synonymous to punishment. Punishment, isn't it? I will be punished every time I will commit mistake. You see? That is classical conditioning. Get the idea why behaviorists became very popular? What is the implication in learning the, I mean, in educating the masses? What is the implication? It's so easy to create change in behavior by manipulating your survival instinct.
It reflects the factory system as well.
The factory system is there. That's why, you see? In the factory, you're conditioned, isn't it, to do a specific task. No brainer, isn't it? You don't need a brain. That's the implication. That's why our students now are still in classical conditioning, because here in Malaysia, I believe students are studying for the A's.
Yep.
Every time they will see letter A, it reminds them of their future. If not, they remind them of their punishment. Isn't it? That is classical conditioning. You see? So how you treat now the people around you, you might be using classical conditioning. I have a boss who enters the office changing his facial expression. Every time he will enter the room, everybody will be very quiet. No smile, just a poker face. As if you're not existing. Every now and then. But the moment you have one-on-one meeting with him, it's a totally different experience. You know? Sometimes it questions your assumption. You know? Why is my boss entering the office as if we don't exist? Say good morning, good afternoon. He will not reply. I said, why are you doing that? And then he told me, I don't like my emotion to be revealed every day. I said, what's wrong with your emotion? So some people are trying to manage, you know, their behavior because of this principle, the classical condition. They want people to see themselves the way they want it. Okay? That is the psychological implication. So every time you will use the same stimulus, the response you get is the desired response. So, the idea here of conditioning is also the establishment of stimulus and response. That's why you will hear the theory SNR, stimulus response theory. For every stimulus, there will be a response. And that is a behaviorist perspective. Okay? Another one, cousin to classical conditioning, is called operant conditioning. This time, it's not only changing behavior through a stimulus. This time, reinforcement is now being employed. Like motivation, isn't it? That's why the more you say, oh, you're so good, you know, you perform well, you feel good, isn't it? And even though your boss is not so honest about it, you feel good, isn't it? You really did great. Then tendency you believe so much on yourself, isn't it? That is what they discovered. And it's still classical conditioning, but this time with a twist. They call it operant because there is another stimulus that is operating on top of the stimulus. Get the idea? That's why students must not only be conditioned by the aid, we have to give reinforcement. Isn't it? This morning, I'm listening to one of the radio stations along the shuttle. I mean, when the shuttle will pick us from our place and bring us to Taylor's, there is a radio station that talks about expectations, parents' expectations to their kids here in Malaysia. You know, and the topic is getting an A. Some of the callers said, oh, I set high expectation for my kids. I want them to perform the best that they can be. No? Then one of the facilitators said, well, what if your kids fail to meet your expectations? That is not an option. Oh my goodness. That's so scary, isn't it? And some parents are like that, you know? Some parents are conditioning their kids that there is no such thing as number two. It should be number one. I saw one movie like that, and it's a real thing. Her mom really, gave so much punishment. Every time she will go back and say, Mom, I'm number two in a class. Until such time, she doesn't like to share it to her mom, but her mom will find out just the same. So punishment is still being needed. That's why she said, there is no such thing as number two in my family. And then she grew up to become a senator, you know, a legislator, and top of the class in law. And eventually she said in her interview, I never satisfied my parents' expectations. I don't think they're happy for what I earn now. You see? So that is the implication of this kind of psychological, you know, condition. Now, operant, this is good. If it is really deserving of a recognition, give a recognition. Isn't it? But if somebody deserves punishment, then because that is also operant condition. So punishment and reward was introduced here. Okay? That's why schools are still using it, isn't it? Get an A, you have a reward. Isn't it? That is operant condition. So that is where our school is coming. Next. Look at this. How is behaviorist looking at learning? Can you read it? Can somebody volunteer to read the first bullet? How is learning and behaviorist? Come on, anybody.
Learning is manifested by the change in behavior.
Okay. So change in behavior. As long as behavior is changed, there's learning for behaviors. Second.
Acquisition of stereotyped responses and observable and quantifiable skills and knowledge.
Okay, look at that. That is where our examination is coming from. Because it's quantifiable, isn't it? You have to get 100 every now and then for you to say you succeed. Below the standard, you fail. That's not learning. How can you say that? The mere fact I failed, I learned. Isn't it? Yeah, it so happened that what you're expecting, I failed to give. My non-knowledge to you is still knowledge to me. See that? Oh, see? Next!
Activity-centered characterized by repetition.
Repetition. That's why in the basic education, you always repeat in order to memorize. See that? But in higher education, we should not do that anymore because our experience tells us that our students entering university have prior knowledge and experience already. How you will enhance it is our key role. Okay? So if you want to become a behaviorist in higher education, you have to use this. You have to repeat it again. You have to set against certain standards. And then the next is?
Reinforcement is the cardinal motive.
Yes. Cardinal. When you say cardinal, it's the major rule. Reinforce. Okay? If it is wrong, punish. If it is good, reward. Then that says the connection between?
Stimulus and response.
Okay. For every stimulus, there's a response. This is how learning is seen by behavior. Do you think it's still happening? Yeah? Yes. Just imagine, it was introduced 1900s and it's already 2012. My goodness, stop it. Let's do something about it, okay? I think the school is still very much behaviorists. No? Look at the goal of education, to produce behavioral change that will ensure survival of human species, society, and individual. Some societies are still like this. Reward and punishment, isn't it? Especially if the government or let's say the society are employing too much authority. You know? You restrict people to behave differently because you want to preserve the status quo. That's the idea. So you create fear, you create anxiety, you create all these things so that more or less people won't behave differently. Okay? Main principle, you have it. You set behavioral objectives, you still do this, isn't it? Something that you want to measure, okay? Competency-based, skill development, importance of feedback, active experience, and so on. So this is how behaviorists employ and define learning. Any question? What do you think? Should we continue with the behaviorist pattern?
No, thank you very much.
No, thank you very much.
So I want to refer back to your earlier example, especially the example you made mention about the radio program. Now, if you set a goal for your kid and you say SPM, you have 8 A's or 9 A's, and at the end of the day, the result is out, and the kid is not able to achieve that set goal.
The kid's achieved it?
No, unable to achieve it.
Unable, okay.
So, is it a good learning outcome for somebody not to achieve it, but at the same time, the person actually passed the exam for the fact that it's not coming out with straight 9 A's or 8 A's, but actually the person passed the exam and even learning has taken place.
So what you're saying is it's also a good learning experience that the student failed.
No,
unable
to have 9 A's or 8 A's.
Unable to
pass.
Yes.
All the subject, maybe it's called B's or C or whatever. Because the reason I'm asking this question, it's like so much emphasis is on scoring A's. And at the same time, even though people coming out from university, coming out with first class, but getting to the working environment, employer will say, oh, they are not employable. They cannot perform, despite the fact that they come out with
eight.
So it's like the tendencies that students are tailored to study to pass and not study to learn.
I think that is the implication that we are seeing now, you know, the way Malaysians are very paranoid about AIDS, you know? That's why I want to call the radio station this morning and say, actually, it's not in the expectation. The question is, what kind of expectation are you imposing? Whether that expectation is the right expectation, isn't it? Getting an A is an expectation. Fine with me. As a parent, I would love it. Okay? But the question is, what is the value of getting A? The real value of getting A is to ensure that students learn, isn't it? Now, isolating learning from the A, that is totally different. Studying for the A is different from studying for learning, you know? So why could we not set the right expectations to our students by telling them the most objective or the best objective why we send you to school is for you to learn? If you're going to give me an A, that will be a plus factor for my happiness. What is important is because at the end of the day, it is you who will use your knowledge, not me. Isn't it? So you set an expectation that are real, you know, and it depends on your students or your children or your child on how he will enjoy and learn from the experience. The dangerous part is to see learning as linear as this, you know? Because remember, this is a linear proposition of learning. This is not scientific, this is not systemic, okay? They just see stimulus response, okay? Change behavior, learning. That's how they look at it. So when you see perspective with this, we know that there is some, or there are some limitations into the approach. We cannot blame them. Science is not so advanced in the 1900s, okay? They don't have neuroscience, they haven't studied the brain yet, they are not exploring the mind yet, okay? So we cannot, but we are not discounting the possibility that we need to diminish some of the practices of the behaviors, okay?
Would you agree that now that we know that the behaviors model is not working, especially in Malaysia, it's been proven time and again that it's not working? A few years ago, I read in the newspaper there are 6,000 students with straight A's, and I frankly do not believe that all 6,000 of them live up to the promises of A's. But would you agree that it requires a certain level of honesty and integrity in a government to actually change this model, especially in our country where a lot of policies happens to be polarized, I'm sorry to say this, on the ground of race? I don't see education changing because the government has a vested interest in perpetuating the current system.
Actually,
and I've seen textbooks,
yeah,
which are so stupid. There's history exercise books that actually tell you, go to a certain page of a textbook and you'll find the answer. And the worst part is this, sometimes if you score too many A's in Malaysia, it's indicative of the student's lack of imagination.
Mm-hmm.
Because the only way you could possibly have gotten all those A's was if you had destroyed your creativity, your entire mind, and you turn yourself into a zombie or a robot and you learn those things. That's how you got your A's. So I wouldn't trust the A's in this country.
I agree with you,
this needs to change.
It has to change, but you have to believe that education is true by its very nature. It's a social good, okay? It must be returned to the society and it should not be politicized. This is one area of our society whereby government believe that in order to maintain a certain level of peace and order, you know, they like to maintain a certain status quo so that the greater majority will not behave differently. No, that's the idea. So I think you will mess education or mix education with politics, then it will be a very dangerous thing. It's like mixing politics and religion, you know? That's the idea. But my position is that education is still the only thing, education is the only thing that will keep humanity. It's not politics, it's not religion, it's education. Meaning, you have to equip every citizen the ability to decide for himself what is good for himself. That's the idea. That's why education, in certain respect, in some societies are suppressed because they don't want the majority to be liberated from ignorance, to be empowered by their knowledge, and to become better person. That's the idea. That's why education are still elitist in most parts of the world. You know, the only people who control societies are the educated and those who learn the dirty tricks in education. That's the idea. Now, that's my position. Okay? So let's move on. Let's discover another one. Let's go to humanists. I like humanists. I'm a humanist person. Have you heard about Maslow, just like Pablo? Have you encountered Maslow?
It's like
Yomita
B.F. Skinner.
Huh?
It's like Yomita B.F. Skinner. B.F. Skinner, the first one.
Oh, the first one?
B.F. Skinner.
B.F., yeah. And then there is a complete name, actually. I decided to shorten it.
Yeah, I said Yomita.
I meted B.F. Skinner. B.F. Skinner is the one in the operant condition.
Oh, what is an operant condition? Okay. I was thinking.
I'm just summarizing because I know you're not an educational psychology student. I'm just giving you some people to go back and research, okay? Now, the most prominent here is Maslow. If you know Maslow, that is a humanist perspective. I will show you later on. Carl Rogers, he has a contribution on the development of learning, okay? Especially on kids, you know, the stages of development. We will see that later on. And then Amnos is more contemporary. His thinking is still very much felt by our generation. Look at Maslow. This is the hierarchy of needs. And I know you're familiar with this. The goal of every individual as far as learning is concerned is self-actualization. That's all. Have you heard about self-actualization? Self-actualization is a level of what? You are already liberated from your ignorance, fear, and everything. Call it in some respect in religion, you're an enlightened individual. Okay? Look at Maslow's category. Physiologically, every human being needs this. Physiologically, you need to eat, you need to rest, you need to, you know, all those things. Breathing, food, water, sex, sleep, you know, excretion and whatever. Okay? So all these things everybody must achieve. You know? You cannot deprive anybody of this. Okay? It's natural. You cannot deprive somebody of breathing. Will you please stop breathing now? You cannot. You know, it's natural. Okay? I don't know about sleep. Some people you deprive of sleep, but it has an effect. Okay? Then next level, according to Maslow, is security. When you achieve this, the next level of desire or motivation is to seek security. That's why you start to wear clothes, you start to wear, you start to have houses, you decided to build gates, you decided to buy security, isn't it? Why? Because you're trying to protect yourself. Okay? So from knowing who you are by needs, basic needs, the next move is to satisfy security. Once you feel secured, then you go higher. You like people to notice you, to recognize you, to, you know, to believe in you, and to belong to you. That's why belonging and love is there on the third level. Okay? So these are our motivation. Next. Once you feel this, you go up higher. You believe more to yourself because some people believe in you, isn't it? So the tendency is you want to see yourself in a respectable level. Okay? That you achieve something, that you are well respected, that you are people believe in you. Okay? Then the last portion there is the self-actualization. Now you can decide. Now you can say what is important to you. Now you can say what are the principles you like to hold. You know? Now you can debate with someone because you know who you are. So for Maslow, in the humanist perspective, from the move to just condition people, the humanist is telling us, no. Each individual is unique and they have their own desire to develop. They don't just follow rules. They don't just blindly copy behaviors. Okay? Learning is happening when all these motivations are met. That's why in our organization, especially in management, they use this. They use this, they combine the humanist approach and the behaviorist. Like, for example, pay and recognition in work. Isn't it? Where is it tied up with the mental model? It's a behaviorist looking at it as reward and punishment, isn't it? But here, the humanist perspective is now added. Companies are no longer providing you the pay, not just the pay. You talk about benefits, isn't it? So the company is moving higher. They provide you security, they provide you insurance, they help you to have your own car, your own house, and so on, isn't it? Then later on, the company will say, oh, I know you need friends, and you need to have your colleagues, and be, you know, at peace with your peers, etc., etc., so you have team building, etc., isn't it? And then later on, they will say, oh, you perform so much, you know, I believe in you, so we recognize you, give you all these awards, etc. And then at the end of the day, people believe you are a very successful person. I don't know how you believe yourself now. Where do you think you are now, as far as Maslow is concerned? Have you reached self-actualization? When I was in the university, my professor said, I don't think anybody can reach the top. I think self-actualization is when you reach the point when you are already comfortable with what you have and who you are. You know, you don't feel anymore the envy. You don't feel anymore, what do you call this? You feel that you are no longer have that feeling of incapacity, you know? So if you reach that point, then you're always willing to take the risk. That is self-actualized person. Meaning you don't anymore care so much of what other people will say. It's about my happiness. Isn't it? Because ultimately, what we want is our own happiness. The happiness that is not being dictated by anybody. You know? You can only be happy in your work now if you are being given a good pay, isn't it? If you are given a reward, you know, or recognition. But minus that, do you think you will feel happy with your work? No, you cannot just work without a pay, isn't it? And not just a pay, it should be a better pay, you know? That's the idea. So this is how Maslow introduced humanists. Now look at this. This is Carl Rogers' concept of a humanist approach. Look at the conversation. What happened? You're laughing. Yeah. What is the concept of the idea of subconscious here? According to Carl Rogers, our measurement of the self is coming from the external. Isn't it? The more you heard people talking about you and saying something about you, the more you build the self-concept, isn't it? And that is where the interplay of behaviorist and humanist is coming in. For the behaviorist, there is no such thing as self-concept. Okay? The humanist introduced self-concept. Here, that is where our initial definition that learning is personal. Get the idea? So in the behaviorist, it's not personal. It is dependent on somebody else. Here, Carl Rogers gives emphasis on self-concept on top of the external. Get the idea? So the more you receive positive reinforcement, the more you believe in yourself. Huh? And the more you become grounded on who you are. Because somebody told me, I'm good, so I'm good. That's the idea. Okay? So in learning, we will see the implication of this theory. Okay? Look at that. Can somebody help me from other people? Learning, what is learning? Can you read so that it will come to our consciousness? Anybody?
Learning is
a
question.
Okay. It's okay, come on.
Learning is a question for self-actualization.
Okay. What else?
Behavior is phenomenological.
What do you mean by that? If that is the first time that you hear the word phenomenological, it means behavior is based on what?
Events.
Experience. Okay? So we change or we elicit behavior because of what is happening around us. We behave accordingly. Okay? That's the idea. That's why phenomenon, from the word phenomenon, means event. Okay? Next, please.
Behavior occurs within the context of personal realities.
Yes. So here, the self-concept gives a new dimension to defining reality. Isn't it? The more you define yourself, the more you like to define realities. You know? You create that, what do you call this? A certain feeling of confidence that I can explain reality based on my own experience or personal experience. Isn't it? If I will tell you, learning is just following rules, somebody will, you know, will react in this ground and say, no, I don't think it's true. Isn't it? So now you create the self-concept. Why? Because it is a personal reality. This is how I felt and this is how I experienced it. Now, the moment you say, this is how I experienced it, self-concept is being utilized. You know? That's the idea. Next.
Self is constructed by the individual.
Good. And last?
Behaviors conform with our notion of self.
Isn't it? You behave. Because how you want yourself to be projected, isn't it? Sometimes when people see contradictory things, like for example, most of my students before the university will see me wearing formal clothes just like you when you are in the university. And then they will see you wearing shorts, you know, and shirt in the mall. It's a scandal for them, isn't it? What? No, this is my first time to see my teacher wearing that, isn't it? I didn't know my teacher can wear that. Why not? I also have a life, isn't it? So that is how we look at things. We explain realities according to our own understanding and expectations. Okay? So here, from behaviorists, Carl Rogers and the rest is giving us idea that learning is personal. Learning is happening not only because you are conditioned by the environment, but also because how you will behave accordingly with the environment, based on your definition of your own reality. Okay? So if you are growing up in different contexts, like different religions, different race and practices and culture, expect there will be differences in opinions. Okay? That's given. I don't know why we cannot accept that. Yeah? And the people that cannot accept that are the people who are educated. You don't see this with kids. Isn't it? Kids will play with anybody. I don't care about your race. I don't care about your faith. I don't even care about your political orientation. Isn't it? We'll just play. That's all. And have fun. But for educated, oh my goodness, you start by the color of your skin. The next layer will be the brand of the clothes you wear. Yeah, isn't it? Sometimes we become so sophisticated and complicated that we don't even know who we are. Huh? I think we're losing track of the self-concept. Isn't it? So here, the goal of education is to reaffirm human qualities, okay? Such as personal freedom, choice, validity of subjective experience. Meaning, your personal experience is valid as my personal experience. Okay? Like for example, the other day, I was so scared. There was a lady, actually maybe mid-30s. Me and my friend was riding in a car and we were stuck in a jam in Kotaraya Road, going to Kotaraya. And there is this bus, the metro bus, stopped by the stoplight, so we are all not moving. And suddenly there is this woman I saw, you know, and it's in front of me, trying to reach something underneath the wheel. I thought it's just a fallen coin or something. And then she just looked at me as if she's so fearful. she decided to lie down just before the wheel. The only thing I can say is, don't move the bus! I was so scared, really, because I'm the only one, and then my friend told me, what happened? What's happening? What's happening? I said, the lady's lying on the road, you know, waiting for the bus to move. And because of scared, the lady, when the man saw and decided to help her, decided to move inside the bus and hide underneath for quite some time. You see, some people define that kind of experience differently. I feel fear, okay? Another man define it, somebody is in need, isn't it? And then when the crowd is now, you know, conscious of what is happening, some of them just look at it because it's an event. But for some, definitely there are concern, there are, you know, yes, reaction. So this is what we are saying, you know? To be a humanist is to see individual experiences valid as it is. Okay? Do not contradict my experience because it's mine, it's not yours. You know? I don't care how you experience it. Okay? Do not impose your experience on my experience. That's the idea of the humanists. So if you put this in the educational perspective, you need to give freedom for your students to explore and define realities according to how they experience it. And it should be treated with respect because it's valid. Okay? That's why when I'm asking you a while ago, how much do you know about the orientations of learning? Some says, oh, I read it. Well, some says, yes, I learned something about it. Some says, I never heard about it. I'm okay with that because it's valid. That is where we will build on. Okay? That's the idea. So here, the principles of experience is important. This is where student-centered learning came out. Teachers as facilitators, and the focus is on the process rather than the acquisition of facts. What do you mean by that?
It's not about the.
It's not about memorization. It's not result-based. You know, it's about the process of learning. That is the emphasis. Okay, problem-solving, problem-based, etc. Okay, so this is where holistic learning started. Now let's go to the mind. Okay, this mind-boggling. Somebody so intelligent decided to talk about the mind. And the most popular people that I can remember is John, Philip J., Kafka, and Brunner. Okay? Let's see their contribution. Philip J. come up with this thing, cognitive developmental stages. Look at this. What is the implication of this in learning? Philip J. said, at a certain point in time, child can only learn as much. There are learning things that they cannot do at a certain point in time. You cannot teach kids 2 years old, you know, the operation of trigonometry and geometry. Definitely. Their brain is not ready. Developmentally, the brain is not ready. That's what Piaget is saying. Okay? At a certain level, it's the same thing, and so on. You know? So here, what Piaget started is to see learning compartmentalizing. You know? That learning goes with level of development. Meaning, your brain is not fully developed unless you reach a certain point physiologically. And physiologically, our brain is somewhat fully developed at the age of 20. That is how neuroscience define it now. So when you are in your early 20s, your brain is fully functional. Huh? And that is also the start of the deterioration of your brain. Why? Why do you think so? Huh?
No improvement.
No improvement. There will be. But what happened when you reach that point? Yeah? What happened? You become more specific and focused, isn't it? unlike during the time when you are in formal schooling, everything you absorb, isn't it? Everything you learn, you know? But once you reach the point, that is a time where your brain will start to select and concentrate. That's why that is where you will say, I will become a teacher. I will become a lawyer. I don't care who you are, but I like to be a lawyer. I like to be a doctor. See? That's the idea. So you're improving your brain on specific concept or ideas. Okay? So that is where cognitive development comes in. And this is the time where kindergarten proliferate, all those preschool. Why it became so popular? Because of this. They found out that it is good that children must be prepared for the step of the formal learning. Don't just bring them to school. No? Because right from the very start, we are already learning. Even during the time that we are in the womb, the brain is working because it's assimilating the information transferred to us through the DNA. You see how nice science is so advanced in our age? Now we can explain things differently, isn't it? Now there is genetics, there is DNA, you know? It's not in the milk. Isn't it? Oh, your baby is so intelligent. Huh? Oh, it's because of the milk. No, it's my genes. This also gave rise to that thing, the milk. Why they commercialize the nutrients of the milk? Because of Piaget's contribution. See? Now you understand why there is milk for 2 years old, now there is milk for 5 years old, now there is milk for all these things, you know? It's just a commercial thing.
Yeah.
They use it. See? So what is the implication to learning? We have to schedule certain knowledge. That's the idea. Because some knowledge, some skills cannot be performed at a certain given time. But since we are dealing with adults in higher education, this is where we should provide the condition for them to make good choices in life. You know, not all students going to universities likes to be what they intend to. Sometimes it's a choice of the parents, isn't it? Go for law, go for medicine, go for this, you know? But sometimes students doesn't really know what they want. I think the higher education level must be provided. The formal operation is there, you know, see? From adolescent to adulthood. So meaning, the mind is fully functional. Okay? Look at Brunner's mode. It's almost similar. According to Brunner, there are learning modes. Some people learn through movement or action. You know? There are people who learn to see images. There are people who likes to learn reading. It's just an abstract thing, you know? Have you seen people who loves to read? Anybody here who loves to read books? They became so passionate about it, isn't it? Sometimes you are detached with the environment, you know? Because you are so immersed in what you're reading, isn't it? You don't care about what's happening, you don't care about the time, isn't it? And you learn more. But some people don't learn that way. Some people learn when they want to do things. They want action, they want movement. That's why I realize now the brain is not only in your head. It's everywhere. It's how you use it. Some people who like to dance so much, their brain are in their feet. Isn't it? Yeah, true. Some people like to paint. Some people like to use their hands, isn't it? Some people who use their imagination. So all these things are now giving us additional information on how we are going to approach learning. Look at the implication. We have the behaviorist, we have the humanist, now we have the cognitivist. Help me. you were interrupted.
Learning is seen from the inner workings of the mind or mental activities. Opening the black box of the human mind is valuable and necessary for understanding how people learn. Mental processes such as thinking, memory, knowing, and problem solving need to be explored. Knowledge can be seen as schema or symbolic mental constructions. Learning is defined as change in a learner's schemata.
Wow. Totally different now, isn't it? From behaviorist to humanist, now it's about your mind. No? How you use memory, how you use all those information, you know? This gave way to the computer programming. That's why if you will study IT, you must be a cognitive person. If you are inclined to use technology, you are more inclined. Why? Because the brain was copied by the technology, isn't it? The computer is a brain image. How it functions, how it processes, how it moves, you know? That is how the ID technology is now defined. It is the operation of the mind. So the closer they get with that technology, they are now defining learning that same context. No? So the functions of the mind is now given importance rather than just freedom, rather than just self-concept. Now we add a new dimension, your mind. How much do you know about your mind? See? So the emergence of this became an added dimension for people in learning or education. So that is the goal, to facilitate the inner workings of the mind for mental activities in order to elicit better learning. Okay? So they said, if you want to know things better, use your brain. Okay? Don't forget about your brain. I always say this even in my office. They are so familiar with me with the word brain. I'm looking for my staff now, a new member of the group. And I asked my two staff, please review the qualification. Okay? The candidates must have extra brain cells. They know that. The idea is for me that the person must be conscious that you will contribute not only in terms of physical productivity, but also mental. Because my department deals with learning. I want extra 3 brain cells. Okay? So that's the idea. Even in my former office, in my former university, they always hear the word brain. Why? Because you should be conscious that there is something in you that operates, not only your emotion. How your brain processes things and how you are thinking defines who you are. The moment you speak and say something, your brain is telling me what is going on. Isn't it? That's why I know if the person is less 3 brain cells and the other is plus 3 brain cells. I mean, that's the idea of the cognitivist. No? So information processing, actions are consequence of learning, memory, perception, imagery, language, etc. Okay? All these are cognitivist. Because these are all cognitive processes. Yeah? That's why your learning perception is important, isn't it? I ask your perception initially, isn't it? That is where I will build on my discussion. See? So that is the contribution of cognitivist. So far, how is it? Three orientations already. Last two. Are we still on? Are we still on? Okay. Any questions so far with the three? Any learning points that you would like to draw before I move on to the next? Because the two are related and very contemporary. Any learning points so far? Is it now changing your perspective on learning? And does it help you now give you a better picture what learning is all about? So far with the three orientations. Okay. Let's move on. Because I will ask a very profound question later on to find out whether all of us have extra brain cells after attending the session. And everybody must say something. Okay? Social learning. Look at it. It's more contemporary. 1977. Okay? Just 3 decades. So within the 3 decades. Here, Vygotsky is another Russian person who told you Russians are so intelligent. They discovered quite a lot in science, in psychology, in medicine. I believe so. I don't know the condition. Maybe you think better when it's cold. You think so?
It's the vodka.
Ah, it's the vodka. See the perception? It's the vodka. You think it's
caviar.
It's the caviar. Oh.
I guess because we look up above, we look up towards the west. Actually, I'm sure the east, south, east come up with some ideas.
I know. It's just that the system of education is highly dominated. But I know the East has its own orientation, but it so happened that it was not written, but I know it's now being revisited and documented, you know? The latest research that they conducted now when they renovated the Forbidden City, are you watching the documentary? Oh my goodness, you know? The system of governance and the standards that, you know, the Chinese set during that time is really of paramount importance, you know. If you want to learn more about all this new development, look for this documentary that they made, 2 Hours History of the World, by the History Channel. You can see the entire history of the world in 2 hours. And you will see how parallel civilization emerged. So this time you see it side by side. Not historically, you know, presented in a book, isn't it? In a book, when you read the book, you don't see the parallel, you know? Something happening in the East and something happening in the West, you know? And how it complements and defines reality. It's really very nice. Okay. Social learning, Bandura and Rother, okay? So try to search all these people that I'm going to share to you later on. You will get the PowerPoint, don't worry, okay? Don't kill yourself in writing. You're like students, you know? When somebody started lecturing, somebody needs to write. Huh? I believe so, because multidimensional learning, okay? Some people love to read, some people love to write. Look at Vygotsky's principle, making so complicated, isn't it? This is social constructivist approach. What is the implication? Look at the arrows, all the elements. It's all over the place, I know. But what is the shift from behaviorist to humanist to cognitivist? What is the implication? Here is Vygotsky's theory of social construction, and he explained it employing the cognitive, okay? And then he moved on and introduced the CPD. You will see the proximal
development.
Okay. Then you will see the role of teachers, the children, okay, the language, because Vygotsky is also into language. Okay. You see the role of intelligence and thinking. What is the implication of this concept map?
It's like a mind map.
Yes, it is a mind map. But what is the implication? What is the movement from behaviorist, humanist, cognitivist? Learning now is seen from various perspectives and elements, isn't it? It's not only about yourself, it's also what is happening around you. It's not only about your mind, but how you process what is in your mind and how you relate with other people, okay? Part of the social construction is your relationship with people. That's why you have teachers, you have language, you know? Language is our bridge to relate, isn't it? And language is our definition of reality. isn't it? How you say things and how you communicate, you are also defining your own reality. So when you declare your realities to other people, you have to allow other people to declare their own realities and see realities in a bigger picture. So social learning is really exposing our learning in various perspectives and in various elements. Okay? So you don't now zero in on just conditioning your mind or conditioning your behavior. You don't just use reinforcement and punishment and reward, you know, just to elicit change. Here, you are looking at the whole spectrum of elements. Okay? That's why social learning became so popular, because it deviates totally from the limited perspective of behaviorist, humanist, and cognitivist. See? So now, some universities are moving and some schools are moving towards this. That's why now they more give opportunities and freedom for students to discover realities and define it accordingly. I've seen one good video in the YouTube whereby, in order to understand different concepts like distance and then science, whereby they study the soil and the insect that lives in the soil, there is one teacher who decided to use GPS as a mode for learning. You know, there is a school in the United States who decided to design learning not in a subject format. It's an experience-based format, meaning other subjects achieve their learning outcome by participating in one activity. So their activity is to go to a particular field where there is a unique insect that grows in that field. So after the harvest, the agricultural harvest, the land is barren, and that is the right time to do some research. So they decided to teach grade 2 or grade 3 students to go to the field and do research using GPS. Yeah? Their objective? To map the entire field where these insects are growing. So the moment they see insect, their GPS will send signal, you know, to the computer that, hey, I found one here, you know, and they will track down the distance and somehow map the entire place. So they achieve their class in science, in math, you know, in language, etc. At the end of the day, they will see that this experience deals with several learning outcomes, unlike the way we do it now. Isn't it? Now you study one subject, one learning outcome, or several outcomes. But it's a subject base. For them, they're studying reality on a more bigger perspective. Another project that I realized is that one project that they did is to map all the symbolic statue within the city, you know, and then they decided to create a map whereby you can find this thing and define it and have a description and present it to the class. So it's a composition activity. At the same time, I think they employ location, you know, the geography and everything, and they came up with a very good project. So all these things now is influenced by Vygotsky's theory on social learning. And most of the learning is done in groups. Why? Because you cannot isolate yourselves from others in order to see the bigger picture. Okay? So that is Vygotsky's contribution. So constructivist is already there. Look at Bandura's triadic determinism. According to Bandura, you have to employ these three in order to come up with a better understanding of reality, meaning learning. Okay? You have behavioral factors, you have the environmental factors, and you have your personal So what is now the implication of this? It's not only about self-concept, it's not only about you, okay? But you are looking at the environment, considering others, and your behavior, okay? What's the difference between attitude and behavior? I think I asked this in some of my sessions. Can you define what is attitude and behavior?
Attitude is approach, it's abstract, and behavior is whatever is translated into act.
Mm-hmm. Very close. What else? Any idea what's the difference between attitude and behavior? Sometimes we interchange these two, isn't it?
Attitude is intrinsic, behavior is extrinsic.
So technical, isn't it? Intrinsic is extrinsic. True! Attitude is an internal condition, okay? It's an internal condition. It may be expressed, it may be not, but that is your internal condition. Behavior is what is elicited, what you show, okay? So these are the actions that you show. So here, for Bandura, it's not only about your personality. It's also about how you behave, isn't it? Because others can only interpret who you are by not looking at your personality. It's by looking at your behavior. Okay? And that behavior is seen also in the context of the environment. So people behave not only because they like it, but because it is their internal condition and they like to behave that way. You see? So here, if we are looking at psychology and learning, you have to understand how your students are behaving. Because their behavior defines their internal condition. If they are not listening to you, if they are preoccupied with something else, then something is wrong. You have to explore. You know? So the idea here is not just to look at them, okay, as someone who is a tabula rasa. Students are not tabula rasa. It's no longer true. Okay? What is a tabula rasa? An empty slate. Okay? It's like an empty vessel that's waiting for you to fill in. Cannot. Because here, especially in the university level, they have a very good experience, amount of experience and knowledge already. Sometimes some students are even more knowledgeable than the teacher. You think it can happen? Yes! Especially now. Because they have the access to information. Unlike before, isn't it? The teacher is the star. You know? Not anymore. Isn't it? It so happened that you're still a traditional learner. Nobody wants to question you. Now, the idea here is to see that for Bandura and Vygotsky, internal condition is important to set learning. Define and study behavior, which is the social behavior, okay? Usually our behavior is defined by society, isn't it? Who judge our behavior? Others, isn't it? Others. And sometimes, even though we don't want their definition, that is their definition of us, isn't it? So the idea here is to see learners from different perspectives. Look at the implication to learning.
Learning is interaction with observation of others in a social context, interaction between person and society and environment.
Okay, so this is social learning. Okay? You have to see people around you. That's why it's nice to see how people behave. Have you noticed that? Did you spend some time just looking at people?
Yeah.
It's so nice to know how people behave.
Yeah, it's
very interesting. You don't know why they are behaving like that. We did a very small experiment, and I think I shared this. we went to the mall when I was handling educational psychology and social psychology in my former university. One of the projects that my students did is to go to the mall, okay, where people are converging quite a lot, isn't it? And I just asked them, start this experiment. One person will just stand at the corner as if he's looking at something. It started with one guy looking at something. And then some of the groupmates will start to, you know, walk and look also. So there are 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. You know what? We created a crowd. And some people are, why is it? And when it is already crowded, the students just walk away. And somebody asks, what are they looking at? Nothing. You know? What is that? That is the crowd behavior. You know? Sometimes one behavior can influence a lot. That is how mad mentality is also created. Just because somebody triggered the right moment. If you see mad group, you know, trying to hurt someone or destroy properties. It's true. Sometimes people don't think anymore. They just rely on others. Come on guys, they are walking in that direction, so we need to go there.
When you are lost, better to follow the
class. You see? That's the mentality of social learning, you know? It has an effect, you know? The environment has an effect on how we will behave, you know? In a theater, somebody will cinema, or somebody will say, there's a bomb! Oh my God, everybody will scatter to their, you know, seat and go out, isn't it? Why? Because it triggers a certain behavior that the crowd must respond. See? So that is how it was translated into theory, that society and environment plays an important role. Now, it's the same theory that supports this one, the constructivist. Very contemporary, but it's not new. Why it's not new? Because he started already about this thing, you know? So it's the same person that we talked about a while ago. From 1896, he is already toying during his youthful years that there is such a thing as constructivist perspective, meaning you give premium to individual to define reality. Then you have Bandura, the social learning theory, and then the most prominent in the constructivist contemporary figure is James Labe and Renger. Okay? These two work together to come up with a constructivist perspective on learning specifically. Look at Vygotsky's contribution to constructivists. The CPD is Vygotsky's contribution to the earlier theory on social learning. Okay? The zone of proximal development is to find out at certain level where learners perform best. Okay? And to find out that level is the most optimal level to move on to the next. That's why they introduce scaffolding in learning. Have you heard about it? Like scaffolding, building a constructing a building, isn't it? You put scaffolding in order to go up. So they use the same framework with learning. They said, with enough guidance, anybody can reach the zone of proximal development. There is no poor learner in this framework. That's why here, the language changed totally. There is no more failure in education. That's why I still believe failure is not the language of education. You believe so?
Yes.
Huh? Up to now, in our transcript, you see failure, isn't it? Even in exam, you declare failure, isn't it? Which is not good, because you're labeling individuals that you are not good enough. which is not good. Here, in their idea of constructivist approach, with enough guidance, the learner can move up to the expectations. That's the idea. That's why scaffolding is now introduced in some schools. One of the most popular systems of education using this is the Montessori schools. Have you heard about it? It's a very heavily guided learning, you know? That's why students there, they don't feel failure. It's only progress. I've known one school as well in the Philippines who use the same thing. No failing grades, not even a numerical grade. You only move from one level to another. When you master the skill and the knowledge, you move to the next. So your grade one classmates does not necessarily end up with you at the same time. Because the pace of learning will differ depending on the student's capability to move from one level to the next. That's why it doesn't mean 1 year you spend in one grade, not anymore. Who says so? Huh? Who started it all? Have you heard? That you need to spend 1 year in one level in order to move to the next. Time is not an element in learning. Some people learn fast. Yeah, some people are a bit slow. But you have to give them the opportunity to move from one level when they already reach the summit. So that is the idea of the CPD the CPD concept on constructivist perspective. Okay? So some schools are using this already. And I think we miss this in higher education, isn't it? I still believe in higher education there should be no more numerical grades, isn't it? Do you think so? Because this is personal learning already, isn't it? This is an individual learning, and this is a choice. I like to become a lawyer. I like to become, you know, a doctor. I need to be prepared, and I need to be trained. And I should not be relegated by my perception or paranoia whether I'm going to get a good grade or not. My objective is to learn. My objective is to be a doctor. You know, not a doctor with all A's. I want to be a good doctor. Isn't it? So this is the stage where we miss, you know? That's why some schools who are using constructivist approach, those who graduated from these schools, I tell you, they don't like to appreciate the grading system. Because for them, they never experienced it from the start. Now you see where the poverty lies, isn't it? Remember the quote a while ago? Okay, another framework that I discovered that is very much constructivist is this one. The role of community, practice, meaning, and identity. See? So simple, isn't it? Learning is defined by where you are, okay? Where you belong. That is where you learn better, isn't it? Because you learn better when you are at peace with the people you are with, isn't it? You learn better when your teacher is okay with you, isn't it? When you are at peace with your classmates and you like them, you like their company, then your identity is fed by the people around you, isn't it? It complements your areas of expertise and strength and your areas of development. And it's also about giving meaning to experience. So here, learning is seen in a very different perspective and learning by doing or us doing. So this is constructivist. You create your world. You create your own definition. It's valid and you have to share it to other people in order to reconstruct every now and then your perspective. You are reconstructing now, isn't it? At this very moment, isn't it? You are reconstructing your definition of learning, your concept of learning, and how you like to use the concept. You're reconstructing the moment. I may not see it, but eventually you are. internally reconstructing. Look at the implication to learning. Anybody from that table, please? You're the only one missing.
Learning is viewed as a process of making meaning. The learner interacts with experience and environment in the construction of knowledge. From the constructivist perspective, learning is not a stimulus response phenomenon. It requires self-regulation and the building of conceptual structures through reflection and abstraction.
Wow! It's a higher form of learning, isn't it? That's why constructivist is the most appropriate for adult learning, especially in the university. Allow your students to rediscover their own assumptions, question their own assumptions, and come up with new perspective. That is the role of the university. That's why the universities are presenting researches, isn't it? But it doesn't mean all researches are hook, line, and sinker you accept, isn't it? Some researches are put into questions and debate. You know, it doesn't mean you did your research. Your research is already foolproof and without mistakes, isn't it? So the idea is construct knowledge accordingly and share it to people so that you will filter out what is the best interpretation or concept of reality. So here, learner-centered, experiential learning, lifelong learning, transformative learning, and reflective learning is very important as a principle. Okay? So you see now the goal of education? Create and facilitate the condition conducive for learning and to allow the learner to substantially control the construction of knowledge. This is challenging for the university. A lot of academics don't believe students are capable. That is the assumption. That is the assumption. But I tell you, they are more than capable. It's just that we don't create the condition for them to use their previous experiences, their concepts, how they explain reality, how they behave at a certain, you know, experiences, and how they came out of it. We never explore that. This one is not practiced in the university at the moment, specifically our university. I think we are very poor in reflective learning. Because we don't do this. We don't talk to each other, we don't question our position, isn't it? We don't make ourselves vulnerable. Being a constructivist is to put yourself in a most vulnerable situation. And nobody likes it, isn't it? We always go to the comfort zone, isn't it? That's why we want to be behaviorists. Because we want to protect the comfort zone. But if you want to be true learner, or lifelong learner, you need to be vulnerable. You need to tell people who you are, what you are, and how you understand reality. It is there we can now meet, you know, and exchange ideas, isn't it? That is where we can explain realities in a bigger picture. It may not be the best description, but at least it's no longer my perspective alone, but I'm adding your perspective in the concept. Okay, so that is how we construct knowledge. Okay, now I have a challenge. I know I still have quite a time. Can you please reflect on this, or else I'm not going to credit your too nasty. Can you reflect on this thing? Given the theories, how can we effectively create the condition for learning to take place, especially now, in our situation, wherever you are? Where do you like us to start? I will wind up with this and bless my learning points. Want to start here? Where do you want me to start here? It's conditioning. Now, let's approach this in constructivist perspective. Can somebody volunteer? Ah, that's a big difference, isn't it? If I will start here, they're already thinking, oh my goodness, don't. If I will start here, it's the same thing. If I will ask you to please, somebody start looking at it and explain to me your perspective, then it will help me. Yes?
Okay, I will relate what I've done recently with my in-house students. Prior to this, I was teaching law students, and because there has been hundreds of years of legal teaching, so you tend to follow a certain structure. So when I was teaching law students, I followed a certain structure, and I think to a certain extent, I can't say that at an undergraduate level that I can apply a constructivist approach to it. But recently, I had to teach law to non-law students, and I'm given a very limited time to do so. And I have to cover a wide range of subjects within a course which lasts less than 15 weeks. And I have to make sure that they understand concepts that are pretty complex for law students. Now, because I have to do things a different way, then therefore there's no format. And when there's no format, the challenge is I have to go and create one. But there's also an interesting part, because if I have to create a new way of going about teaching non-law students at all, then I don't have a set format. And then that allows me to explore different methods of teaching them, and also to use different language. Language that are suitable for lawyers are not going to be suitable for non-lawyers. And if I have to teach just the main concepts, and I can't go into a lot of exceptions, then I have to make an impact. It has to be bang, this is the idea, okay, you got that. And therefore, I could try different methods, and one of which is I get students to act out the law problem. So I get them to do a role-play presentation. So during mid-semester, they can actually stand out there and they act out the problem. You create your own scenario. And I find that when students have to write a script, they know the law, but you write the script. You tell me how this problem can occur. And you tell me how you are going to solve this. And I find that they understood the problems better than merely hearing it
from the lecture.
In a lecture. And then my students got even more creative. Some of them actually began to make short videos.
Yeah.
And of course, I used those to show the later batches, the later semester, the new intake. And from then, it kept improving, and I find that students now can learn better. And whereas I don't think it's necessarily a constructivist approach yet, but at least I can quite confidently say that for more than 50% of the teaching method, it moves away from the behaviorist.
That's good. That's good.
So
I think what is the word that will describe your approach is your sensitivity to context. You realize through your own teaching engagement that context is a very important thing to consider. Now, it's not saying that constructivist and social learning is the best. No. There are still knowledge that you need to use behaviorists at a certain extent, you know, that you have to be aware that your learner is a human being and it's not somebody that, you know, like a dried sponge that absorbs liquid. No. So I think combining our appreciation now of these five learning orientations gives us a bigger perspective on how we will approach students and learning, isn't it? I think that is a very important input that we can consider. Context. Context defines the needs, you know, and defines the parameters how students will behave at a certain, you know, given situation or scenario, like for example, role playing, you know, or coming up with a video or something. I think these are some of the elements that are already within us, but we don't know it. We're not aware that you are using certain theories and certain orientation. You know, I hope this thing provides you also a bigger picture now, not just merely experimenting on something that is unknown to you, but but these are things existing, and it's existing in time. As early as 1900s, the orientation is already there.
And I think it's really good, because now that we go through the five orientation, I come to understand why is it that if I give students a midterm test before they've done their role-play presentation, they tend to do relatively poorly compared to if I give them a midterm test after their role-play presentation, because their presentation, the process of constructing
experience,
a bigger problem,
yeah,
and finding a solution would have enhanced their experience. And therefore, when you give them a test,
they are more confident.
Yes, and
yeah,
it's almost as if all the problems and the learnings has been internalized.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. And anybody else? That's a very good. Can we give? I didn't know I have a lawyer in my crowd. Anybody? Come on. Just say some of your reflection. This is now the time, the reflecting learning. How do you think this theory will help you improve your current approaches in learning?
I think for art and design, it applies all these theories to apply because, let's say for example, different modules like drawing classes, live drawing, and then in the foundation level, how it works is the students from the foundation level, they move up to the degree level, and you will see that during the fundamental year, they learn by copying,
mm-hmm,
yeah, they learn by practicing, they learn by repetition. Okay?
Apprentice.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, you have the master apprentice kind of thing going on. And then as they move to the first year, you will see that they try to find themselves, kind of like a cognitive thing to learn.
To imagine and create,
yes,
you know, and improve on the experience.
Mm-hmm. And then when they go to the second year, they're closer to, because it's a commercial kind of art, graphic design, interior, and multimedia. So they learn about their surrounding, you know, social learning. And then at the end, and they apply appropriately, appropriating what they have learned into different culture that they would eventually end up working in. So I don't know, the way I see it, it could be applied that way, and it is being
done. How do you think it will improve now, given this whole package of orientation
okay,
that you have now?
I would say that perhaps all five could be implemented in each year, not necessarily, you know, chronologically working from very basic level right up to the highest level. So that means all the five theories could be utilized in their own ways in each module, perhaps in every year.
I think
that's
the
very general.
Yeah, the uniqueness of your area, especially the arts and the humanities, this is where we see more reflective learning. You know, which is not found in some courses, you know. To a certain extent, some courses are more on theories and more on, you know, principles and, you know, all those things. But in the arts, there are more leeways to construct, you know, because they use imagination, they use creativity, you know, all these things. And it's more profound, you know. That's why there are a lot of new literatures pointing to this direction, that learning will again be dominated by this thing in the next generation, maybe 2 decades and 3 decades come, arts and humanities will emerge again.
I just want to add one more thing about the constructivist. Actually, constructivism was an art period as well.
Definitely.
And it was for the people. That was why the Russian constructivism kind of artwork, I could. Suddenly, when you were talking about that, it tied into
the
Bolsheviks.
It started already in the Renaissance period where the arts and the classicals are there.
It's
already constructivist because they are expressing their ideas of realities and social issues through the arts at the time. That's why we produce quite a lot of imagery of the past because of this. And I think it will come into that point after the technology age comes again. the arts and humanities, I tell you. It will come again. Okay, thanks. Another one, please.
In the School of Medicine, we are doing problem-based learning. That day we were discussing, we were telling what is problem-based learning. So what we do is that we divide the students into groups, small groups, and then problem is given to them. Scenario is given, clinical scenario is given, that a patient comes to you in the outdoor or in the emergency, presenting with these complaints. So then, you know, this problem is given to them. And then they have to come up with their learning outcomes. So they construct their own learning pattern, you know, what they want to learn. So they take out the issues, and then, because we are the S facilitators, we are given the learning outcomes, but we don't tell. I don't tell them that these are the learning outcomes. I want them to come out with their own learning outcomes, what they want to learn out of their problem. So they come out with their problems, and then they go and search for an answer, and they have to divide the problems amongst themselves. So they interact with each other also, and they share the knowledge during the process of searching, and then they present it. And they can present anyway. They present in a paper, or they can have a PowerPoint slide, or whatever. So this way, you know, many aspects are covered, because they construct their own learning pattern, and they interact with each other and also with the other groups, because they are encouraged to
present and
present and also to share knowledge among themselves. And most of the answers, if they still are left with some learning outcomes which they don't find an answer, so first of all they will ask each other. They are encouraged to ask each other, and somebody should bring the answer also. In the end, still they don't have an answer, then they come up to us and we will tell them. So I think we can improve it more, yes, based on these,
I think the benefit that I'm looking at from the science group, especially in medicine, is to see that the practice is not a simple master and apprentice relationship. You know, in medicine, there is a level of exactness, isn't it? The level of proficiency.